Belinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of The School of Magic, Book 2, The Return of Rathalorn, written by Dave Luckett and read by Stanley McGeagh. The dedication reads to SF fandom and other members of my family. Prologue. The lady in the hooded cloak probably thought she wouldn't be noticed. She was wrong. But then again, she wasn't used to neighbourhoods like this one. For one thing, she had come in a closed sedan chair carried by porters, and that was very unusual around here. The porters waited for her in the dark street. They were big, burly men, and both of them were carrying cudgels under their coats. But even they were looking around in a careful sort of way. For another thing, there was her cloak. Although it was very plain, it was made of rich, heavy material, and it was full cut. The lady probably thought it was the sort of thing most people wore, and so it was, where she came from. It was just as well, then, that she only had to go two steps from the sedan chair to the door. The street was no more than four steps wide, and the buildings leaned over it from either side. The door seemed ordinary enough. It creaked when it opened. Beyond it was a steep set of narrow stairs. The lady shot a glance over her shoulder that told anyone within sight she wasn't supposed to be here, and then she entered. At the top of the stairs there was a landing, and just off the landing another door. On the door was a card in a brass frame. There were just two words written on it, Master Rathalorn. The stairs were dark, but the door was framed in golden light. She knocked, and after a moment it opened. Unlike the one to the street, it swung on well-oiled hinges. Light spilled out. She blinked, looking for the person who had opened it. And then she looked down. He was short and squat. For a moment, she thought he might be a dwarf, like her friend Lady Cotilde's. But no, Lady Cotilde's dwarf had a beard that came to his middle. This was just a little man. Ordinary, clean-shaven. He looked up at her, his head on one side, his face asking a question. "I am," she began, but he swept her a bow, cutting her off.
"No names are needed here," he said. "You have come to consult my master. Enter, then."
He waved her inside and closed the door behind her. The room wasn't as she had expected. It was filled with light, for one thing. Three oil lamps hissed, the largest of them casting a pool of yellow light over the round table in the centre. She had expected shadows and odd things in bottles, candles and skulls, bubbling retorts. And there was indeed a shelf of musty books, but apart from that, there was only the table, two chairs, an inner door, and a perfectly ordinary fireplace. The evening was warm, and there was no need for a fire. But one burned in the hearth anyway, making the room too hot. The little man was standing patiently behind her. She turned her head, and he made the gesture a butler makes when he offers to take cloaks and hats. She hesitated, then shrugged out of her cloak, revealing that her face was masked from brow to upper lip. The little man didn't seem to notice. He hung the cloak on a peg by the door, climbing on a stool to do it. She turned, and as she did, the inner door opened. The lady had been expecting exotic robes. Master Rathalorn was wearing a blue tunic and breeches. They were clean and neatly pressed, but ordinary. She had been expecting mystic gestures. Her friend Lady Cotilde consulted a soothsayer whose fingertips drew strange patterns of light in the air. But Master Rathalorn only nodded at her in a perfectly normal way, his hands behind his back, saying nothing. She licked her lips. She didn't know what to say, and she wasn't used to that. The thing was, no matter how he dressed or acted, Master Rathalorn looked anything but ordinary. He was tall and slim, with long, beautifully shaped hands. But it was his face that drew you in, and his eyes most of all. Gleaming in the lamplight, There were large eyes, slightly tilted, and they were golden. Really, truly golden. The eyes of a true high elf. His hair was of a gold 2 shades lighter, long, tied in a simple braid that brushed the nape of his neck. Master Rathalorn smiled.
There is no need for masks here, lady.
His eyes seemed to be looking through her at something else, something beyond.
Lady Lydiana, is it not?
Lydiana's hand rose to her mouth.
How did you know? You have never seen me before. I told nobody I was coming here. Nobody. Even my porters did not know until we were actually in the street.
He shook his head.
Strange, very strange. You come to me for knowledge, and now you are surprised to see it. Sit.
He pointed at the chair on the further side of the table. She sank down on it, and he seated himself opposite her.
What would you know, then?
She leaned forward, then half glanced over her shoulder. Rathalorn saw it. He seemed to see everything.
You need not be concerned for Gregory, but no doubt it is best to be in private.
He raised his voice.
Stay by the outer door, Gregory, and make sure we are not disturbed. Take the second lamp. You'll need the light on the stairs.
The little man bowed and left, closing the door behind him, and the light in the room became less bright.
Now, how may I help you, Lydiana?
She made a last attempt at cleverness. I should have thought you could tell me that. Again he smiled.
Well, let us see how far I can read. You are married. Yes, and you have a child. No, children. Is it about those children? No, I see it is not. It's your husband, isn't it?
She gasped. How did you know? Again, Rathalorn seemed to be staring at something distant. He paused before going on.
He's become bad-tempered and hard to live with. But that's not it, is it? No, he's always been a bit that way. But lately he's been neglecting you, coming home late, night after night. You wonder what's going on.
Yes. It was no more than a whisper. Rathalorn stared over her shoulder, and his eyes seemed to glow in the lamplight. He watched the shadows for a long time.
Ah, yes, I see. It is whispered to me that on that score you need have no fears. He is, in fact, working every night in his business.
He smiled gently.
He's a cloth merchant, is he not?
Once more her eyes widened in shock. It was uncanny. This man was staring straight into her mind. She nodded. He frowned a little.
So much for the present. The future is more difficult. There are always so many paths that branch off. I must see your hand.
Wordlessly, she offered it, palm up. He took it and gazed at it, sitting still as a stone for a long count of 20. Then,
I see a ship, many ships.
He looked up at her face.
I see gold, much gold. But here the path branches. I see a little way down both paths. Down one lie wealth and cheering crowds and a chair among men in scarlet robes.
She gasped again, but he appeared not to notice.
Down the other, it is dark, but not all dark. I see wealth to come, but not so soon.
Rathalorn folded her fingers over into her palm and released her hand.
I can see no more than that for now. It will require much more work to cast a full horoscope and descry the crystal.
She fumbled in a purse.
Please, please, go ahead. I can pay.
Rathalorn smiled. Of course she could pay. He named his fee, a high one, and a date to return. As she put down the gold, he clapped his hands. Gregory came in from outside to help her into her cloak and see her out. When the manservant returned, Rathalorn was standing by the window staring out into the night. Gregory, whose real name was Gilly Bagshaw, glanced at a pile of gold coins on the table.
His eyebrows lifted. "Not bad," he remarked. "I thought it went pretty well. You could have told her that her old man would know in 3 weeks how rich he'd be. That's when the silk fleet's due in. It might be late. It might even get sunk in a storm. So I had to cover myself for that. But have you seen the silk prices lately? If the fleet does get in, he'll be rich, richer. And that means election as a master of the cloth guild. Hence the bit about Scarlet Rose."
"Yep."
The little man swept the coins up into a bag.
"It took you a while to learn finger talk, but it's paying off now. Really, marks are so stupid. How hard can it be to remember that you've got your name sewn into your cloak?" "She's probably never noticed it. She's got a maid to do that sort of thing for her."
Rathalorn's voice was distant, and he was staring out of the window again. Gregory tied up the bag.
"Or that her sedan chair has a family crest on its door, the sign of a pair of shears and a balance scale. That's meant to say cloth merchant loud and clear. And any cloth merchant with his own chair must be rich enough to have a big share in the silk trade."
"How did you know her husband wasn't a master of the cloth guild already?" asked Rathalorn.
"The porters weren't in guild livery, of course. I knew that skylight over the door would come in useful. You didn't have any trouble seeing the shadows on the ceiling through it?"
"Some. It took a lot of concentration to read the signs you are making." Rathalorn paused. "I thought it was pretty sharp of me to say that her husband had taken to coming home late."
"Not all that hard to work out. She'd only be able to come here if she knew for sure he wasn't coming home early tonight. But yeah, that was neat. The rest of it was just centering, suggestion and watching her closely, like I showed you. And your gift of always being believable is a great gift for this business. A magical gift like that is always handy, but it really helps a fortune teller when the marks believe anything you say."
He grinned.
"This is good, Rathalorn. We make a great team."
Rathalorn's eyes gleamed. "Oh, yes, Gilly, you're so right. It is good. I never felt so good about doing something. It feels wonderful. And this is just the beginning."
Chapter 1, The Magical Twins. Rathalorn, once a high elf of Silverwood, looked out across the fairground and shuddered. It was noisy, dusty, smelly, and crowded with humans. Many of them were eating sausages and buns. Those things were disgusting, like all human food, but not half so disgusting as the name of that horrid, sweet, fluffy stuff that they ate off sticks. Faerie floss. Rathalorn was from a fairy. The idea that you could give that name to something made from sugar dyed pink was simply revolting. But he had to put up with it. There was no choice at all. Rathalorn wasn't here in the human world because he wanted to be. It wasn't all bad, mind you. He was finding that there were some things about it he quite liked. It was so good to actually be clever at something, for instance. His family had always considered him a dunce. He wasn't forced to be at this fair. He was here for his own reasons. He didn't need to stoop to telling fortunes at fairgrounds anymore. He'd given up working the fairs long ago, as soon as he'd made his first a big payoff. These days he had many wealthy customers for his horoscopes and his crystal readings. He'd made a lot of money, once he'd realized how stupid humans really are, and he'd done it in only a year. A year. A human year. Not a long time by fairy standards, but an eternity in the human world. It was enough time to get thoroughly dirty, enough time to get it into his skin and under it, so that he'd never feel clean again. They'd exiled him to here from Faerie. The Council of Mages had found him guilty. Guilty of what? Of trying to put that jumped-up little commoner Tipkins in his place. Him and his human charges, that boy Alan Plog with his gift of truth-telling. And the girl who could give anything to anyone. Dink, she called herself. It was
the... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.